Welcome back to the online class, students. So in today's class, we are going to start with the new topic. It is called as the proteins. Okay. So let us see the introduction of proteins. So proteins are complex organic compounds. Okay. So they are made up of different types of amino acids which are held together by the peptide bond. So we can define the proteins as what? So they are made up of different types of amino acid. Okay, so these amino acids are held together by the peptide bond. Okay, so the bond present between the amino acids or the bond present in the proteins is the peptide bond. Okay, so the protein, the term protein was given by Berzelius. Okay, the term protein was given by Berzelius. But officially, so it has been used by Mueller, so in the year 1838 in his book. Okay, so the person by name G.J. Mueller, so he used the term protein in his book in the year 1838. So as we know that, so the proteins are made up of different types of amino acid. So I can call the amino acids as building blocks of proteins. So, we can call the amino acids as what? So, they are called as building blocks of proteins. They are called as building blocks of proteins. These proteins are chemically made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen. So, they are made up of, chemically they are made up of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen. Okay, and so the term protein is used for a polypeptide made up of more than 50 amino acid. Okay, so we can make use of the term protein if a polypeptide consists of more than 50 amino acids. So many, if it is containing more than 50 amino acids, we can call such polypeptide as the proteins. Okay, so let us discuss about the amino acid, then we'll be discussing about the proteins in detail. Okay, so amino acid, as we know that what are amino acids, so the amino acids are the building blocks of the proteins. Okay, the amino acids are called as building blocks of proteins, and so there are different types of amino acids are found, but only 20 amino acids are involved in the protein synthesis. How many amino acids are involved? Only 20 amino acids are involved in the protein synthesis. Okay. So there are nearly 200 to 300 different types of amino acids are found in the nature. For protein synthesis, we require only 20 amino acids. So even our body requires some other amino acids, but not for protein synthesis. For example, there is amino acid called as ornithine. So, ornithine is the amino acid, so which is required. So, this amino acid can be used for urea, in case of uric acid cycle. Okay. So, in case of uric acid cycle, so, we can see the involvement of ornithine, but it is not involved in the protein synthesis. Okay. So, when you consider the amino acid, so these amino acids consist of one carboxyl group and so one amino group as the functional groups. Okay. So, each amino acid, when you consider it, consists of one carboxyl group, that is COOH. Okay, and so another functional group is amino group. So this amino group is NH2. Okay, so each amino acid consists of carboxyl as well as the amino group. And so when you see the structure of amino acid, so as I told that each amino acid consists of one carboxyl group and one amino group. Okay. And not only that, even you can find the presence of a hydrogen and So, a variable group that is represented by R. Okay. So, there is a variable group represented by R. Okay. As you can see, the two major functional groups are carboxyl group and amino group on the same carbon atom. So, this carbon is called as alpha carbon. This is called as what? Alpha carbon. Okay. So, then, so the amino acid which consists of alpha carbons are called as alpha amino acids. Okay. So, the amino acid which consists of, so the alpha carbons, they are called as what? Alpha amino acids. Okay. Then next, so these amino acids are also called as substituted methanes. They are called as what? Substituted methanes. So, why they are supposed to be called as substituted methanes? Because what is the formula of methane? It is CH4. Okay. So, the valency of carbon is 4. In case of methane, so it is satisfied by 4 hydrogen atoms. Okay. So, we are calling the amino acid as a substituted methane because the 4 valency of carbon. Okay. So, in the place of H, so we'll have 1 COOH. So, one more NH2. So, one hydrogen is replaced by COOH, one hydrogen by NH2, and one hydrogen is retained as it is, and another hydrogen is replaced by the variable group R. So, hence, so the 4 valency of carbon is replaced by the, so the 4 functional substituted groups, hence it is called as the substituted methane. Okay, is it clear? Then next, so with the help of the structure of amino acid, so we are going to see, that is the changes in the variable group, we are going to see the different types of amino acids. So if R is replaced by the functional group, so as it suggests, it is the variable groups. Okay, so only R will be varied from one amino acid to the another amino acid. Okay, in the place of R. So, if we replace it by H, okay, in the place of R, if we replace it by H, so this amino acid is called as glycine, okay. So, it is called as what? Glycine. So, it is the simplest amino acid, okay. Glycine is the simplest amino acid. So, in the place of R, if we replace the methyl group, that is CH3, okay. So, we'll have one carboxyl group here, one amino group and one hydrogen is as it is. In the place of R, if it is methyl group, okay, CH3, so this amino acid is called as alanine, okay. So, it is called as what? Alanine. Then next, so in case of, so the variable group, if it is CH2OH, okay, if it is CH2OH, we call this as serine. The amino acid is called as serine. So, these are some of the examples of the amino acid and their structure, okay. Now, the amino acids, as I told that, so the amino acids are connected by what type of bond? Peptide bond. They are connected by peptide bond and forms into protein. Okay. So, the two amino acids. So, the two amino acids. For example, this is one amino acid. This is the another amino acid. So, they are connected by peptide bond. Okay. It's called as the protein. Okay. So, let us see how this peptide bond has been formed. And we know that, so the polypeptides are also called as proteins. So, in case of polypeptide, the term poly represents many. So, many proteins, many peptides will be there due to the many amino acids. Okay. So, hence the name polypeptide. Let us see the peptide bond formation. So, how this peptide bond has been formed? Peptide bond, it is the chemical bond formed between, so carboxyl group of one amino acid with the amino group of another amino acid with the release of one molecule of water. Okay, so that is the definition of So peptide bond. So let us see that. So as I mentioned that, so it is takes place between the two amino acids. So let me write the general structure. Okay. So here is the COOH. So NH2 and H, then a variable group. So another amino acid right here. COOH carboxyl group, NH2. Here we have hydrogen. Here is the variable group. So as we mentioned that the bond formation takes place between the carboxyl group of one amino acid with the amino group of another amino acid with the release of one molecule of water. So NH2 I'll write like this. So NH2. Okay. So as I told that, so the bond formation takes place between carboxyl and the amino. Now what will happen here? OH of carboxyl combines with the H of amino and there is a release of one molecule of water. Okay. So this is how the peptide bond has been formed. So you can see that the carboxyl group of one amino acid, so it combines with the, so amino group of another amino acid with the release of one molecule of water, the peptide bond has been formed. Okay. So this is regarding peptide bond. Then next. So these amino acids are also called as amphoteric compounds. Okay. So we can call the amino acids as what? Amphoteric. So what is the meaning of amphoteric compound? So amphoteric means, so they act as acid as well as base. Okay. So amino acid has the nature of acting as an acid, so as well as base. Hence we'll call them as the amphoteric compounds. Okay. Then next, we can call amino acids. So amino acid also exhibit Zwitter ionic nature. Okay. So they also exhibit what? Zwitter ionic nature. So what is a Zwitter ion? Zwitter ion means, so the amino acids will have a positively charged group and the negatively charged group on the same molecule. So it's called as the Zwitter ion. Okay. See, for example, the Zwitter ionic structure of amino acid is, so here CO- NH3 plus, and hydrogen is as it is, and here is the variable group. So can you find here? So here is the negatively charged and here it has the positively charged group. Okay. So hence amino acids exhibit Zwitter ionic nature. Okay. So based on the number of charges, we can classify the amino acids into three types. Okay. So let us see the classification of amino acids. Okay. So classification, the first classification is based on number of carboxyl group, that is COOH, and amino group NH2. Based on this, so we can divide amino acids into three types. That is, first one is acidic amino acid. Second one is basic amino acid. And the third one is neutral amino acid. Okay. So, well, in case of acidic amino acid. So, before that, so as I told that, so the two major functional groups are carboxyl and amino group. So, the carboxyl group is responsible for acidic nature of amino acid. And the amino group is responsible for basic nature of amino acid. Okay. So now, in case of acidic amino acid, so the number of carboxyl groups are more when compared to the number of amino groups. Okay. So the number of carboxyl groups are more than the number of amino groups. Okay. So such type of amino acids, we are calling it as the acidic amino acid. One of the example is glutamic acid. Example for acidic amino acid is glutamic acid. Next is the basic amino acid. So here, so basic means which functional groups? So, amino functional group NH2 is more when compared to the COOH. Okay. So, NH2 amino groups are more when compared to the carboxyl group. Such amino acids, we are calling it as basic amino acids. So, now the example is lysine, arginine. Okay. So, these are basic amino acids. So, these two basic amino acids are involved in the formation of a protein called as histone protein. So, this is involved in the formation of DNA. Okay, this is found in DNA. So, it's a most important one. You should remember. Then, next is the neutral. Neutral means the number of carboxyl groups is equal to the number of amino groups is called as neutral amino acids. Okay. So, the example is valine. Amino acid called as valine is the example for neutral amino acid. Okay. Then next is even there are some of the amino acids are there which are also called as aromatic amino acids. Like, so some of the examples for aromatic amino acids are tyrosine, tryptophan, phenyl alanine are the some of the examples for aromatic amino acids. So now let us classify the amino acid based on requirement. Okay. So based on the requirements, amino acids preferably classified into two types. Okay. So the second type of classification is based on, so it is based on requirement. So based on requirement, there are two types. The first one is non-essential amino acids. Another one is essential amino acids. Second one is essential amino acids. So, non-essential amino acids are those which are produced in the body. Okay. So, non-essential amino acids are nothing but the amino acids which are produced in our body. So, they are called as non-essential amino acids. Okay. And hence, there is no requirement of involving them as a part of the food or diet. Okay. So, non-essential amino acids are those which are produced by our body. Hence, there is no requirement. So, hence there is no requirement to involve or include them as a part of diet. Okay. So, some of the example for non-essential amino acids are, so like glycine, alanine, serine are some of the example. So, here you should remember. So, they are produced in our body, but they'll be playing a vital role like other amino acids. Okay. The next is the essential amino acids. Essential amino acids are those, so which are not produced by our body. Okay. Essential amino acids are those which are not produced by our body, but they are important for growth and development of an organism. Hence, they are supposed to be included as a part of diet. Okay. So, essential amino acids are those, so which are not produced by our body. They are not produced by our body. Hence, they are supposed to be included as a part of diet. Why? Because it is required for the growth and development. They are required for growth and development of our organism or individual. Hence, essential amino acids are should be involved as a part of diet. Some of the examples are like methionine, okay, leucine, isoleucine. So, these are the some of the amino acids which come under the category of essential amino acids. In some cases, even we'll consider one more category, that is semi-essential. That means, so which is supposed to be a part of diet, particularly in a particular period of the life cycle. Okay, like for example, during the growth period or during the lactation. So they're supposed to be included as a part of a diet. Okay. So even we can conclude majorly two types. So even the third also is that is semi-essential. That means, so these amino acids are included as a part of diet only during a particular period, like lactation and growth period, they are supposed to be included. Okay. So these are the classification of the amino acids. Okay. So let us discuss about the structure of proteins. Okay. So the next topic is structure of proteins. Okay. So here, so protein shows four different levels of structures. Okay. So protein shows four different levels of structure. They are primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary. Okay. So the next topic is structure of proteins. Okay. So this is exhibited at four levels. Okay. So the first one we are going to see is the primary structure or primary proteins. Primary structure or primary proteins. So as we know that protein is, so it is the polypeptide chain or the amino acids are connected by peptide bond. We'll call it as what? Proteins. So here, the proteins, the linear sequence of amino acids is called as primary structure of proteins. Okay. So primary structure is what? Linear sequence of amino acids is called as primary structure of proteins. So you can see that one amino acid is connected to the another amino acid and forms just like a straight line. Okay, so we are supposed to assume it as a straight line. When we consider that, so the left end of the polypeptide chain represents the first amino acid. So the left end represents the first amino acid. Okay, and the right end, so the right end represents the last amino acid. Okay. And so this left end is called as N-terminal. Left end is called as N-terminal. So the right end is called as C-terminal. So why it is called? So let me write the general structure of proteins here. Amino acid. So that is C functional. So, when we write the general structure of the first amino acid, so here you can see that it starts with the amino group. Hence, it is called as the N-terminal. Okay. So, when we write the general structure of the, so the last amino acid, it is similar. So, COOH and NH2, hydrogen and variable group. So, it ends with what? Carboxyl group. Hence, we are calling it as the C-terminal. Okay. So, the best example for a primary structure is the insulin. So, example for primary structure of protein is the insulin. So, usually, so the proteins and the primary structure, so they will be non-functional, but exception with the insulin, which is the functional protein. Okay. And in case of primary structure, the bond formed is peptide bond. The bond formed here is the only peptide bond is formed. Some cases, so this primary structure, so also shows a coiling. Okay, so the linear structure may be found as just like a coil structure. So this is regarding primary structure of proteins. The next one is we are going to study with the secondary structure of proteins. Secondary structure of proteins. So in case of secondary structure of proteins, so here, the polypeptide chains are folded to form a helix-like structure. Okay. So, the polypeptide chain is folded to form helix-like structure is called as secondary structure. Okay. So, in case of secondary structure, you will find peptide bond along with that hydrogen bonds are formed. Okay, so what are the bonds here? It is peptide bond. Along with that, the hydrogen bonds are seen. Okay, so hydrogen bonds, where you can find these hydrogen bonds? As I told that, so here the amino acid, the polypeptide chain is found in the form of folded. So it will be found folded and found in the form of helix. So when you consider this, so here, for example, the beaded structures, if you consider this as the amino acid. Okay, so these are the amino acid. So this is one amino acid, this is the another. So the bond formed is the peptide bond. Okay, then, so the bond between one amino acid and the helix of another amino acid here, the bond formed is hydrogen bond. Okay, that is, here CO group will be there, here NH2. So the bond between hydrogen and oxygen, the bond will be formed, that is called as hydrogen bond. Okay, so in case of secondary structure, we'll find peptide bond between the amino acid as well as the hydrogen bonds are formed. So this is called as helix structure. If the hydrogen bond is formed between the amino acids of the same polypeptide chain, so we'll call it as alpha helix. Okay, so example for alpha helix structure is the protein called as keratin, which is found in the hair. Okay, so another structure also you can find in case of secondary. So if you consider the two polypeptide chains, so this is the one polypeptide, so this is another polypeptide chain if you consider. So on that, so if you consider this beaded structure as the amino acids, and we know that, so the bond between the amino acids of polypeptide chain is the peptide bond, and so the amino acid of one polypeptide chain is connected to the amino acid of another polypeptide chain by the hydrogen bond. So it results in a beta fleeted structure. Okay, the structure formed by the hydrogen bonds of two adjacent amino acid results in the formation of beta pleated structure. Example is silk fiber. Okay, silk fiber is the example. Okay, so this is regarding the secondary structure of proteins. The next one is tertiary structure. The most important one is the tertiary structure of proteins. Okay, so why it is most important? Because most of the molecules in the cell so exhibit tertiary structure. So the next one is tertiary structure of proteins. So in tertiary structure, so the polypeptide chain, the single polypeptide chain is folded upon itself. Okay, so it is folded upon itself to form a hollow ball of woolen like structure. Okay, see, for example, so a polypeptide chain, it is folded upon itself in a different direction. Okay, so to form a hollow ball of woolen. Okay, so it is folded upon itself to form a hollow ball of woolen like structure is called as tertiary structure of proteins. Okay, and so due to the this repeated folding, so it gets the three-dimensional view. Okay, so three-dimensional view, due to the three-dimensional view, so these are most of the biological molecules are active, so in the tertiary structure. Okay, most of the biomolecules and the molecules in the cells exhibit tertiary structure and they are functional, are active in that. Okay, and so the bonds formed here is, as we know that, so the bond formed between amino acid is the peptide. And when you consider, so between the amino acid of, that is CO and NH, so there is the hydrogen bond has been formed. Okay, so other than this, even we can see the formation of the some of the ionic bonds. Okay, so the ionic bonds are also formed and hydrophobic bonds are also formed here. Not only that, when you consider the amino acid containing sulfur. Okay, for example, this is one amino acid containing sulfur. So this is the another amino acid containing sulfur. The bond formed between these two is called as disulfide bond. Okay, in tertiary structure you can see peptide bond, hydrogen bond, ionic bond and disulfide bond, due to which it will get the three-dimensional structure. Okay, so the best example for a tertiary structure is, it is myoglobin. Myoglobin is given of the example, and we can take the example of the enzymes. Okay, but these are, so at particular temperature or at high temperature, at high pH, so the structure, the tertiary structure of proteins are disrupted. When the tertiary structure is disrupted, so they will lose their function. Okay, the process is called as denaturation process. Okay, the process is called as what? Denaturation process. The next structure is quaternary structure. Okay, the protein exhibits four levels of the structure. The last one is the quaternary structure. Quaternary structure. So, in case of quaternary structure, so here, so two are more than two polypeptide bonds, polypeptide chains are required. Okay, so two are more than two polypeptide chains, so they associate to form into a particular structure is called as the quaternary structure. Okay, so in case of primary, secondary and tertiary, so only the single polypeptide will be involved generally. Okay, but in case of quaternary, so there is involvement of two polypeptide chains or more than two polypeptide chains are folded upon, or they are associated to form a particular structure is called as what? Quaternary structure. The best example is hemoglobin. So hemoglobin is made up of four polypeptide chains. In that, two are alpha chains and two are beta chains. Okay, so two are alpha and two are beta chains. Okay, so this quaternary structure also consists of the bonds like the, so peptide bond, hydrogen bond, ionic bonds and disulfide bonds are also found in case of quaternary structure. See, for example, as I told, two alpha. See, if you consider, so this as the, so alpha chains, and here you can consider this as the two beta chains. Okay, so they associate to form a complex structure called as quaternary structure. And when you consider the protein, which is the abundant protein in the animal world, it is the collagen. Collagen is called as the abundant protein in the animal world. And in case of plants, as well as in the biosphere, the abundant protein is called as Rubisco. Okay, so it is Rubisco is called as abundant protein in the plant kingdom, or in the, even in the biosphere also, when you consider, so the abundant protein is the Rubisco. The full form is Rubulose bisphosphate carboxylase oxygenase. Okay, carboxylase oxygenase is the, so full form of Rubisco. Okay, so this is regarding today's class. Let us see the some of the questions related to the topic. Okay, which one is the abundant protein in the animal world? So in the animal world, which is collagen. Okay, so the options are trypsin, hemoglobin, collagen, insulin. It is collagen. The next, which of the following is the simplest amino acid? Alanine, aspergine, glycine types. That is glycine, which are functional group as the, variable group as H. Which is an essential amino acid? A, serine. B, aspartic acid. C, glycine. So D, phenylalanine. So phenylalanine is the one of the essential amino acid. Okay. Thank you, students.